Welcome to the United Church of Christ, Fort Lauderdale, where no matter where you are in your journey, you are welcome here. Welcome to our worship service today, where the theme is love at the core. We need to remember always to do everything in our lives with a loving attitude. This month is also breast cancer awareness, so we wish to recognize and pray for all those who are currently fighting the good fight, and also those who have conquered this disease. As we continue with the service today, please know that God is still speaking.
Amados, nos han llamado a que nos amemos los unos a los otros porque el amor es de Dios. El amor de Dios se derrama sobre nosotros desde que nacemos. Nos han llamado para extender el amor de Dios a todas las personas. El amor de Dios se nos ha enseñado a través del testimonio de la gente y la fe de Dios. Nos han llamado a proclamar el amor de Dios en todo lo que hacemos y todo lo que decimos, en toda la creación, en todas nuestras relaciones, que el amor de Dios sea reconocido. Beloved, we are called to love one another because love is from God. God's love is poured in us from our birth. We are called to extend the love of God to all people. God's love is taught to us through the witness of God's faithful people. We are called to proclaim God's love in all that we say and do, in all creation, in all our relationships. May God's love be made known.
Oh,
Church of Christ of Fort Lauderdale, our mission is to develop passionate followers of Christ through the celebration of worship, the excitement of God's word, the blessing of God's healing, the rewards of service, the honoring of God's creation, and the joy of fellowship, where all are welcome at God's table. We are a welcoming, open, and affirming church to all people of all races, genders, ages, sexual orientations, professions, previous religious affiliations, nationalities, or mental and physical conditions. The first reading today is taken from Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 through 8. You yourself know, brothers and sisters, that our coming to you was not in vain. But though we had already suffered and been shamefully mistreated at Philippi, as you know, we had courage in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in spite of great opposition. For our appeal does not spring from deceit or impure motives or trickery, but just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the message of the gospel, even so we speak, not to please mortals, but to please God, who tests our hearts. As you know, and as God is our witness, we never came with words of flattery or with a pretext for greed, nor did we seek praise from mortals. Whether from you or from others, though we might have made demands as apostles of Christ. But we were gentle among you, like a nurse tenderly caring for her own children. So deeply do we care for you that we are determined to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because you have become very near to us.
The gospel reading today is from the book of Matthew, chapter 22, verses 34 through 46. When the Pharisees heard that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, asked Jesus a question to test him. "Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest?" Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment," he said. "And a second is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Now while the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them a question. "What do you think of the Messiah? Whose son is he?" "The son of David." Jesus said to them, "How is it then that David by the Spirit calls him Lord? Saying, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet. If David thus calls him Lord, how can he also be his son?" No one was able to answer Jesus, nor from that day did anyone even dare to ask him any more questions. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The worship theme today is love. Love at the core. There's all kinds of songs about love, television shows, love exciting and new. Come on board, we're expecting you, the love boat. We have songs like Looking for Love in All the Wrong Places. So many songs about loves and poems and books and movies and churches. Love. Love at the core. But when we talk about love, what do we mean? I hear people all the time talk about certain foods. I love hot dogs, someone might say. I love my job, another may say. I love that television show. I love my children. I love my cat. I love my spouse. Personally, I love macaroni and cheese, truly love. But then there's, I love God. So many ways that we use the word love in the English language, it has so many different meanings in the context of which we speak. In the Greek, though, there are seven different words for the word love. There's eros, which is a sexual desire, meaning for love. Philia, which is love of the mind, which is known as brotherly love. It represents a sincere and platonic love, a love that you might have for a brother or for a sister. There's also the love called ludus, playful love. Love that's flirtatious and teasing. The love that's accompanied by dancing or laughter. It's a childlike and fun kind of love. There's pragma, which is the love between a married couple. This kind of love develops over time. It's the highest form of love. It involves true commitment that comes from understanding, from compromise, and from tolerance. In the Greek, there's agape love. It's selfless. And it means the love for humanity. There's philautia love, the healthy kind of love we give ourselves. It's essential for any relationship, loving ourselves so that we may be able to love others. And there's storge love, the love the parents naturally feel for a child, the love that's based on natural feelings and effortless kind of love. Seven different meanings of love. And in that love, there's a component of forgiveness, acceptance, and sacrifice. So love expressed seven different ways. But one thing we know for sure is love is alive. Love is alive indeed. From 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 through 8. In this communication from Paul to the Thessalonians, he's talking about reminding them of how they established their relationship, the trust and the love that was built between them over time. Paul was also pointing out his authenticity of the Gospels and that his preaching wasn't motivated by any self-interest, that it was truly the love of God and the Holy Spirit flowing through him in his message to them. You yourselves know, brothers and sisters, that our coming to you was not in vain, but though we had already suffered and been shamefully mistreated at Philippi, as you know, we had courage in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in spite of great opposition. Paul sharing with them that he persevered in getting the message of Jesus Christ to them. He demonstrated God's desire for them to get to know the gospel message. For our appeal does not spring from deceit or impure motives or trickery, but just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the message of the gospel, even so we speak, not to please mortals, but we speak to please God. Again, Paul reminds them of his authenticity. He continues, as you know, and as God is our witness, we never came with words of flattery or with the pretext for greed, nor did we speak praise from mortals, whether from you or from others, that we might have made demands because we were apostles of Christ. But we were gentle among you, like a nurse tenderly caring for her children. I love that imagery. We were gentle among you, like a nurse caring for his or her children. Is that how we present the gospel of Jesus Christ when we talk about that? Is that how we live? An authentic lifestyle. People are all worried about different kinds of lifestyles, they call it, but how about the lifestyle of love and authenticity? This text, this first text from Thessalonians, this answers a lot of questions. Today we're going to be talking throughout this message about how to love, about who to love, and about what love is. And we know that love is the core. The how? Paul answers, gentle, like a nurse, tenderly caring for her or his very own children. That's how. If I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but do not have love, I have become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and know all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith so as to move mountains, but do not have love, I have nothing. And if I give all my possessions to feed the poor, and if I surrender my body to be burned, but do not have love, it profits me none. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not jealous. Love does not brag, and love is not arrogant. It doesn't act unbecomingly. It doesn't seek its own. Love's not provoked. Love doesn't take into account a wrong suffered. Love doesn't rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices with the truth. And love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and love endures all things. We're told that love never fails. But now faith, hope, love abide these three, but the greatest of these is love. That's what love is. And that's the direction on how to love. Next part of the sermon is who to love. That's answered in today's lectionary reading from the book of Matthew. Jesus is very clear on who to love. All we have to do is not difficult. All we have to do is listen. When the Pharisees heard that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, decided to ask Jesus a question to try to test him. Teacher, which commandment is above the law, or is the greatest in the law? And Jesus said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. Jesus says, and this is the greatest commandment. And a second like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And on these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. We'll always remember the words of you shall love the Lord your God with your heart, mind, and soul. But most of the time we miss the most important part, because it says with all of, and with all of. This text is about not only about love, but it's about commitment. And for commitment, these two commandments hang all the law and all the prophets. Are we committed to Christ? Are we committed to our neighbor? Are we committed to ourselves, to become the Christians we're called to be? Love your neighbor as yourself, meaning black, white, brown, Muslim, gay, straight, rich, poor, immigrant, Jewish, Buddhist, transgender. The world is our neighborhood. Jesus clearly revealed to us through his ministry that there's no such thing as an immigrant. There's no such thing as a foreigner when you talk about his love. That the world is our neighborhood. So we reflected on what is love, how to love, who to love. And lastly, this last part of the gospel reading today, I love this a lot, because Jesus turns the tables on the Sadducees and the Pharisees, whose attempt was to test him. So he decided to test them. Now, while the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them a question. What do you think of the Messiah? Whose son is he? The son of David. And he says, how is it then that David by the Spirit also calls him Lord? So how can he be the son and also refer to him as the Lord? You can't both have both. If David does call him Lord, how can he be his son, Jesus says. Jesus asks them. Well, I would love to have been a fly on the wall. Scriptures reveal to us that no one was able to give him an answer, nor from that day did anyone dare to even ask him another question. That's a difficult text. Why did Jesus turn the tables on them and ask them that question that tested them? And I strongly believe that Jesus was revealing to them that divine love can't be logically explained. That love is love. and love is. We aren't called to give love or do this or that, but we're called to be love. And when we are love, the other things happen. It's so easy for us not to be able to answer the same question until we realize that we are love. We must be love. Thank you, Jesus, for sharing with us how to love, who to love, what is love, and how to be love. Amen. October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month, thus the pink shirt and clothing. The color pink is used throughout the month of October to remind us that to be aware of breast cancer, to remind us there are people who have died from that, people who have survived, people who are advocating now for a cure, people who are fundraising and doing more. We have breast cancer survivors in our very own family here in our congregation who work diligently to support others and to help find a cure. So we bless them and we honor them today.
Let us pray. Thank you that you, Lord, are a loving, gracious God. Thank you that you've offered us forgiveness and the gift of a new life in you. Thank you that your love is perfect, it never fails, and that nothing can separate us from your love. We pray that our lives would be filled and overflowing with the power of your love so we can make a difference in this world and bring honor to you. We ask for your help in reminding us that the most important things are not what we do outwardly. It's not based on any talent or gift. But the most significant thing we can do in this life is to simply love you and to choose to love others. Lord, thank you that your love is patient. Help us to show patience with those around us. Lord, thank you that your love is kind. Help us to extend kindness to others. We pray for our world and all suffering from COVID-19. We pray for the families whose loved ones have suffered and died. We pray for our world leaders, may they choose peace. We pray for oppressed people, may we take a stand and create change and justice. We pray for those undergoing challenges and difficult times. We call their names out loud now. We now sing the prayer taught to us by your Son, Jesus.
Thank you. Love, love changes everything. Hands and faces, earth and sky. Love, love changes everything. How you live and how you die. Love can make the summers fly, or nights seem like a lifetime. Yes, love, love changes everything. Now I tremble at your name. Nothing in the world will ever be the same. Love, love changes everything. Days are longer, words mean more. Love, love changes everything. Pain is deeper than before. Love can turn your world around, and that world will last forever. Yes, love, love changes everything. Live or perish in its flame. Nothing in the world will ever be the same.
Myself, I am grateful for so many things. Amongst them are my husband Nick, our life here in Florida, our home, and our cats, Missy and Abby. For our circle of close and caring friends, there are so many other things that I could say today. As Election Day is just around the corner, I remember to be grateful for the freedom to vote, for the freedom to have a voice, for the opportunity to have a voice in the world here or in our country. I'm grateful for those many, many people who have stood for hours and hours in line to cast their own votes. I am thankful and I appreciate their dedication and their commitment and their patience to be willing to do that. So if gratitude is a state of being, something that we strive to live out each and every day, each and every moment of our lives, I think it's important to learn to be grateful for everything. Not just for the good things like I've mentioned, but also to learn and strive to be grateful for the difficult times. For those challenging times when we almost give up hope, when we can't see our way through. I think in being grateful we open ourselves to God's blessings, to God's showing us a way through. And so my hope for myself and for all of you is that we learn to be that, to have that constant state of being grateful in our lives. So I'd like to leave you with close with a brief quote. Maybe even you could say it was a prayer. This is one of my favorites. It's from the mystic Meister Eckhart. He says, "If the only prayer we ever say is thank you, that will be enough."
Holy Communion, here at United Church of Christ, Fort Lauderdale, all are welcome at this God's table. All who hunger to know Christ and to be close to the divine are welcome here in this place.
Will you please pray with me? We have bread and cup and heart. Our church community is dispersed in distance, but we are one in Christ. In your many kitchens and living rooms, rest your hands lightly upon these elements which we set aside today to be a sacrament. Let us ask God's blessing upon them and upon us and upon those who are praying and in our prayers this morning. Gentle host, you prepare a table before us in the threatening presence of virus. You anoint our hearts. Bless our bread and our cups overflow. Surely we shall shelter in place. We find both the goodness of community and the mercy of those most vulnerable. Now all the days of our lives we claim that this house, these many houses where we dwell, and our precious church building are indeed the house of God. Send your spirit of life and love, power and blessing, upon your children who are staying at home so that this bread may be broken and gathered in love that this cup poured out to give all hope. Risen Christ, live in us that we may live in you. Breathe in us that we may breathe in you. Amen.
On the night that he was to be betrayed, Jesus gathered around a table. Just like we're gathered around the table today, no matter where we are, here in the church or in your home, and we gather together. But that night he gathered together and something different happened. Jesus took the bread, he blessed it, he gave thanks for it, and he broke it. And he said to those gathered there, and we can hear his words today, he said, "This is my body to be broken for you. Take and eat and remember me."
In the same way at the end of the supper, he took the cup from the table and he had given thanks. And he gave it to his disciples saying, "Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant my life poured out for each of you. When you drink of this, remember me.
Let us pray. Thank you, Holy One, for these sacred gifts of your creation. You created the universe, the earth, the grape, and the grain. May these elements today become the very essence and presence of Jesus Christ, your Son. We thank you for blessing them, and it's in his name we pray. Amen.
The table of the Lord is now set, offering us forgiveness, strength, wisdom, compassion, and most of all, grace. All are invited at Jesus' table.
I invite you now just to take a breath. Take the elements that you've gathered together in your home, a cracker, a piece of bread, and juice or water. Just gather them together. They have been blessed. And we partake of the bread and the cup. Let us pray. We pray thanksgiving for this meal of grace, rejoicing that in the holy dispersion of your virtual worship, we claim the risen Christ's love is not limited by buildings made with human hands, nor contained in human ceremonies, and celebrating the God's shepherding that carries us into the unknown to listen and to follow, to lead and be led, to feed and to be fed. We thank you for this gift. May it renew us in body and spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
That you were moved today by God's love and grace while viewing our worship service. We hope to see you in person one of these days. We here at the United Church of Christ, Fort Lauderdale, are an open and affirming congregation, which means everyone is welcome here. We have numerous ministries that reach out to the needs of our community. That creates opportunities for all to serve, should you choose. We believe that God is still speaking, and he speaks through our ministries and our outreach missions to bring people to Christ. Please go to our website, www.uccftl.org, and there you'll find more information about our church. You'll be able to submit the name for our prayer group to rehold in prayer, to view previous worship services, and should you choose, to donate to our church and its missions. We look forward to hearing from you soon, and may God's peace be with you. And remember, God is still speaking.